this weekend, the reason I don't have more people with me, tomorrow my husband is celebrating 23 years at the church.
Hey, he'll
be celebrating his 23rd anniversary. Really have anybody. My mama is sick today. She was supposed to be here to introduce me, but you know what? This whole thing, when life hands you lemons, I'm going to sound like some lemons. The devil was trying to give to me, but I got something to do with those lemons.
All right.
But I do thank God for one of our members, Sister Rosalind Lee, came with me, and this is like my church daughter. This is Adrian. So I'm glad for those who were able to come with me, and I know everybody else is looking this way by faith and praying for me. And I ask that you all will pray for me, pray with me, because I'm nervous as I don't know what, you know, standing before people that knew me before I really knew myself. But just pray with me, and I'm going to pray right now and just ask God to just cover this. Dear Heavenly Father, I come right now asking that, God, that you just touch me with your Holy Spirit, oh Heavenly Father. Lord, sit in the shell down and stand your Holy Spirit up within me, oh Heavenly Father. I pray that the people here, God, will hear and receive a word from you, God, knowing that it's not about me, it's not even about them, oh God, but it's about you, and it's about the Spirit that dwells richly in each one of us, oh Heavenly Father. Lord, and I just thank you for this opportunity. I thank you for the vision of Tabitha, oh God, and I just pray and ask that you continue to bless her, oh God, and lead her where you would have her to go in order for her to be the visionary and the leader of what she's trying to do with the Dream Girls, oh God. Lord, I pray for everyone who's here, every mother, daughter that's represented, oh Father. Lord, I pray for my mother who's homesick. I pray for my grandmother, oh God. Lord, and I just pray and ask that you will just move in this place.
Yes,
you will be my voice, oh God. Just lift me up right now, God. I pray and ask it all in your son Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
So our theme for this morning, when life hands you lemons, and when Tab sent me that theme, I was like, wow, that sounds like my life, because it seems like for a long time that's all I was getting was lemons. And when I looked at the scripture of Romans 8:28, I was like, okay. And so that scripture reading, we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love them, who have been called according to his purpose. But we don't want to stop there. We want to read on through. For it says, for those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. So when we talk about for those God foreknew, that means that even when I was walking the streets of her and doing things I shouldn't be doing, God knew that one day I was going to be standing in here speaking for him, because he predestined it. Then it goes on to say, and those he predestined, he also called. Those he called, he also justified. Those he justified, he also glorified. What makes me feel so good about that is knowing that because he called me, he justified me. It means I don't have to get justification from anybody else. He's glorified in the justification that he's given to me, and not just to me, but to everybody in here, because we've all done something. My pastor always says we're all ex something, and so none of us are without sin. So God has justified us, and we give him the glory for it. It goes on to say, what then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? You know, so many times we listen, we get caught up in what people are saying about us and what they think about us. But if God is for us, he's more than the whole world.
I know that's right.
So we don't have to worry about what the people say. We're here for the glory of God. He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake, we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, and you know, when I got to this part, so many times when you hear this verse, and I'm reading it all because it all fits in, you know, you don't want to just read one passage of the scripture. You need to know the whole context of it. But when it says no in all these things, when you're listening to that, you think that they're saying no, like K-N-O-W, but it's saying N-O, no, like no. In all things, we are more than conquerors. So no matter what's been said in front of us for our bad, for that the devil meant for our bad, we say no in all things that's happened in our life, it's been for the good, because whatever we've gone through, God has put us through all of those things for him to get the glory on the other side.
Amen.
So it says, no, in all things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I'm convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in creation will be able to separate us from the love of God and his Christ Jesus our Lord. I read all of it because when, and I guess you say, well, what does that have to do with when life hands you lemons? Because it's saying that when whatever God has done for us, it's for our good. And you know, when we're given lemons, God has given us all good things. But life has sometimes handed us out some lemons. And Jarvelin put something on Facebook just the other day, and I saw it, and I was like, wow, she must have knew what I was going to be talking about. Because Ted was talking about when life hands you lemons, and Jarvelin say, well, I still say, what you going to do with your lemons? That's my topic, what you going to do with your lemons? And most of the times, you know, I've been to different places and heard different people speak, and they talk about when life gives you lemons. And my husband even did a demonstration one time where he made some lemonade in the pool pit, because you know he was talking about when life hands you lemons. And most of the time that's what people think about, is life hands you lemons. That's just a cliche. Well, we'll make lemonade. Well, I don't like lemonade for one, so I'm not gonna make lemonade. Everybody doesn't like lemonade, you know. I don't like anything lemon. I don't like lemon cake, I don't like lemon pie. So even though you sweeten up all those things with the lemons, I don't like it, so it doesn't work for me. So what am I gonna do with my lemons? I'm gonna give them back. You like lemon cake, a lemon toss or whatever, then you make that. But you can't put that on everybody, because not everybody likes lemonade. So I'm going to give my lemons back. That's what I'm going to do with mine. I prefer tea, just so you know. I like tea. And I don't like lemons. I like peaches and strawberries. I'm not different. You know, don't try to hand me something that I don't like. But that gets to my first point. We've got to stop settling for things.
Come on.
You know, so many times we settle. Because somebody comes and hands you something or gives you something, if it's something that you don't like, you don't have to take it. When life hands you something that you don't like, God has given us the power to rise above and to do something else. We don't have to just settle. Philippians 4:19 says, and my God will meet all your needs according to the riches of his glory in Jesus Christ. So we don't have to settle for the hand that we've been dealt. We have been given a promise from God that he will meet all of our needs and do above all we could ever think of hope. In Ephesians 3:20, it says, now to him who is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we ask or think, according to the powers that work in us. So we've been given the power. We don't have to just settle for what life hands us. You know, do something else with it. Just because you might have had a child out of wedlock, just because you were a teenage mother, you know, things happen, but the devil means it for bad, but God means it for good. So don't just settle for nothing. Because I had this child, you know, out of wedlock, you know, what the world is going to say about me. I just saw on the news yesterday, this young girl in Chicago, she's graduating as a valedictorian of her class, but yet she had a baby when she was in the eighth grade. She's been homeless. Her mother and her and her two siblings, they were homeless. They were in CPS custody. But this girl is graduating as a valedictorian of her class in 2 weeks with that little baby that she had when she was in the eighth grade. And she said that was her inspiration. The people, she said she had one teacher who told her when she was in the 10th grade, she was like, well, you know, you might as well go on and quit school because you're not going to be anything. You got a baby, you know, you need to just try to find you a job. But what did she do? She handed that lemon back.
Yeah.
Because that teacher tried to give her a lemon and she didn't know. She didn't like the taste of it. So she says now to that teacher, look at me now. I'm graduating at the top of my class. God has made us to be the head, not the tail. He made us to be the head, not always. So we need to do what God has destined us to do. He predestined. He knew that girl was going to have a baby when she was in the eighth grade. He knew what she was going to come up against. He knew the obstacles. But through it all, he gave her power. How many of you know that God has given us power? Whatever it is that we want to do, if we ask anything everything in his name. Yes. He says that if it's according to his will, yes, he'll bless us. Amen. But that's our problem. We need to line up with his will. Yes. Yes. We want to do what we want to do. Yes. You know, we're on our own thing. But when we line up with the will and the word of God, God will bless us. We have so much power. And women, you know, they have this show now, Black Girls Rock. We really do rock, and we have the power to rule the world. But we need to learn where that power comes from and stop leaning on our own understanding. Number two, we don't need to be afraid to ask for what we want. So many times we're afraid to ask for what we want. So if somebody hands you a glass of lemonade, like I saw they were passing out lemonade, and I don't know if everybody took it, don't be afraid to ask. They had orange juice, they had water, they had coffee. But if you just take what somebody gives you, then you sit there and it's like, wow, I really didn't want this. I really would rather have some water. But because they gave me this, I'm just going to drink it. No, don't be afraid to ask for what you want. If you want some orange juice, if you want some water, ask for whatever it is you want. We can't be afraid to ask God for what we want. We have to go to him and ask. He's our heavenly Father. And just like you ask your earthly parents for things, God knows everything that we want. He knows the desires of our hearts. But just like you know what your children want, but you wait on them to come and ask you for some things, God is waiting for us to come to him and ask him for the things that we want and the things that we desire, because his desire is to give them to us. He wants us to have them. But when we just go about, you know, business as usual and be like, well, okay, well, this is all I have, you know, all I have is a high school, you know, diploma, I didn't graduate from college. Okay, well, what's stopping you? It's not too late. You, if that's what you want, ask God to give you what you need to get it. Last year at 45 years old, I graduated from college with my bachelor's degree. I asked God to be able to do it. I started school off in 1987 when I graduated from high school, and it just didn't work out for me. But as my son was getting closer to when he got to middle school, I started thinking about, you know, I don't want to be that parent that just tells him what he needs to do. I want to be that example that he can see that, you know, my mama didn't just say it, she did it. And so when he saw me being a parent, working full-time, going to school full-time, and still making the grade, he don't have no excuses. He just graduated with his associate's degree and is getting ready to go to U of H. But when things got too hard for him and got too rough, he could draw on my strength and say, well, if my mama didn't give up with everything she had going on, how can I give up? You know, so we have to be an example, but we have to ask God. Things come and they're hard and we struggle, but when we ask God, he'll give us what we need. So don't be afraid to ask for what you want. Next, we need to live with expectation. 1 Thessalonians 5:16 says, rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. So what this is saying is that we need to just praise God in advance for what he's going to do. You know, don't wait for the blessing. There's a song that say, don't wait for, what is it? Don't wait for the, shout now. What is it?
Somebody help me.
Y'all know that song, don't wait for the,
don't wait for something, go ahead.
Yeah, don't wait for the shout now. Don't wait for that new job that you're looking for. Don't wait till the battle's over. Shout now. So when we're going through some things, you know, we need to shout now. We need to praise God in everything. If you've got a hard taskmaster on the job, if you're going through some things, don't wait until it's all over. We need to praise God right now for it. If we can praise him while we're going through, think about what we're going to do once we get. Yeah. Come on. Whatever it takes, come on. He's got the power to bring us out of it. So we need to shout now. We need to thank God in advance. Even with those lemons, until you decide what you want to do with them, thank God for the lemons for right now. But then you decide what you're going to do with them. If you're going to give them back, if you're going to make your lemonade, if you're going to sweeten it up, but shout right now for whatever he's giving you. Because God is good and he's worthy of all the praise. Next, you need to be authentic. 1 Corinthians 2:9 says, however, as it is written, what no eye has seen, what no ear has heard, and what no human mind has conceived, the things God has prepared for those who love him. God has a blessing with your name on it.
Mm-hmm.
What's for you is for you.
Mm-hmm.
And I read a quote that says, there's nothing more rare nor more beautiful than a woman being unapologetically herself, comfortable in her perfect imperfection. None of us are perfect, but God has created us all in his image. And so we need to be satisfied with who we are. You know, growing up, I used to always think, you know, well, I'm not light enough. You know, I'm too dark. You know, my hair is not long enough. You know, I'm too fat. I'm too this. But God made me. And when he made me, God doesn't make any junk. So we need to be satisfied with who we are and how we are. Because God created us in his image. And we are unique individuals. And we need to be satisfied then. And we need to be real. And we need to stop trying to be like somebody else. You know, again, me a lemon, he gave Tab a lemon. All three of us might do something different with those lemons. We don't have to do the same thing. I shouldn't want to be like you. You shouldn't want to be like me. We should all be striving to be like Christ.
Amen.
But yes, we need to be ourselves, be happy with who we are. And that's the problem with so many of us. You know, we're not happy with who we are. And the reason we're not happy with who we are is because we don't have the right relationship with Christ. Because when you are in a right relationship with Christ, you will be happy with who you are. You know, it says that this joy that I have, the world didn't give it to me, and the world can't take it away. But we have to understand that there is a difference in joy and happiness.
Yeah.
Because things can make us happy, but God gives us joy. So we must remember and know the difference between joy and happiness. And know that that joy that we have, the world didn't give it to us, and the world can't take it away. But when you depend on people, they'll make you happy. But the only people that made you happy will make you sad. They will break your heart and make you cry. But God will give you joy, joy unspeakable joy. And thank God for that joy. But be authentic. Be yourself. This is a mother-daughter conference. Teach your daughters that they're beautiful. You know, tell them. And I don't want to put her on the spot, and I'm not going to tell everything about her story, but this young lady right here, one of the reasons that I brought her, all I'm going to say is you all pray for Asia when you say your prayers, because things just aren't as well as they should be. Mm-hmm. But you all pray for her. But what I want you to know is that we got to stop putting our mouths negatively on our children.
Come on,
you're not going to be anything. You're ugly. You're dumb. How can you tell somebody that who you birthed? How can you tell your children things like that? You got to encourage them. I remember my son used to come home from school sometimes, and Blake, he was always real little, and he had a big head. He finally grew into that head, but he didn't have a big head anymore. But you know, I never told him he had a big head. I never said that to him. You know, people would come home and be like, Mama, my kids teased him at school. He'd come home crying. Like, you know, they say I got a big head and all of this. And I would always tell them, baby, what you have, God gave it to you. And when those kids are teasing you, you tell them that God gave you this big head. And he put a lot in it. You know, you got extra smarts. Yeah. That's why he gave you that big head. But find a way to make something positive out of the negative. You know, don't tear our children down. And that's what's happening in our society so much. We tear down, we tear down, we tear down. But what God wants us to do is be building up. Yeah. Especially, I know this is a mother-daughter, but those of you who have sons, build up your young black men.
Yeah.
Build them up, because the world is tearing them down.
Yeah.
We need to be building them up. We need to be encouraging, because those black men are going to be the ones that are going to marry your black girl.
Yeah.
So you want some strong men that are going to be good men for your daughters.
Yeah.
So we need to build up, and we need to encourage. And like I said, I didn't mean to put her on the spot, but you all know that there's a need for prayer for this young lady. When it's over, I want us to all, you know, I don't want to step out of order, but I would like for us to just all gather around and just pray for her. But we need some strong women who will step in and be mothers.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they used to say it takes a village to raise a child, but we've gotten away from that now. You can't tell nobody else's child nothing. You know, I remember when I was growing up, anybody could tell me anything. I was good before I got home. Somebody told me. But now you tell somebody's child to do something, and that parent can tell my child what to do. See, I didn't raise mine like that because what was good for me was good for him also. But now one thing I will tell you though, and I've always said that when it comes to mine, if you're not training yours the right way, don't try to train mine.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
One thing you gotta take care of your own home first. So if you're not doing your job, then how you gonna tell somebody else how to raise
their
child?
Yes, ma'am.
If your child walking around with his pants hanging down, how you gonna tell my child to pull mine up? So take care of your home first before you go trying to be somebody. Another quote that that I read and that I like, it says, as I look back on my life, I realize that every time I thought I was being rejected from something good, I was actually being redirected to something better.
Yes.
We have to realize that when we pray, and you know I said don't be afraid to ask for some things. So even when you ask, if God doesn't give you what you ask for, know that it's not because he doesn't want you to have that. He wants you to have something better. So when God doesn't answer the prayer the way you want it, know that he's got another blessing with your name on it, and it's better than what you thought you wanted to begin with. You know, sometimes he has to take some things away from us in order to give us what he really wants us to have. Because sometimes we'll go through, you know, and all the lemons we get, life didn't hand them to us. Some of them we really end up by ourselves. Sometimes we think we know more than what God knows.
Yeah.
We think we know what we need, but we know what we want. God knows what we need. So make sure that when you pray for something, and if you don't get the answer that you want, know that it's not because God doesn't want you to have that. He wants you to have better. Because God always wants to give us his best. And because he wants to give us his best, we should be willing to give him our best.
Amen.
We shouldn't come before God with just junk requests anyway. And that's what some of them are. You know, it's like, oh God, you know, I'm just by myself. I need a man, Lord. Send me this man. I just need somebody to be in my life. Just need somebody. When you pray that prayer, he's going to send somebody. He's going to come. And it's not going to be who he sent you either, because he's not going to send you just somebody, but he will allow just somebody to come into your life. And then when you see that that was some junk, then you're going to go back and be like, okay, be specific with what you want. Like, okay, God, I need this man to be about 6'2". I need him to be, you know, kind of chocolate color. I need him to make at least $100,000. Be specific. I told you, don't be afraid to ask somebody for what you want. And if he don't give it to you, then that means he's got something better for you. It might be the man that comes that's 5'6", $25,000 a year, but he treats you like a queen. So we can't get confused with, you know, material things and looks and stuff. We can be specific, but we gotta have an open mind that, you know, God might send you that tall, dark, and handsome brother, and he laying up while you going to work. Is that what you want?
Mm-mm.
So be specific, but also have an open mind, because that might just be a lemon coming your way, and you want to get those lemons back. Our next one is trust in God. Jeremiah 29:11 says, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. So God, like I said in the beginning, he predestined us. He knew from the very beginning, even before he formed us in our parents' womb, he knew what we would be. And God wants us to prosper. He wants all of us to prosper. And we have to realize that prosperity isn't always about money. You know, we can be prosperous in good health. We can be prosperous in a loving family, because not all families are loving. You know, I look a lot of, you know, I be on Facebook, and one of the things that I've always liked, and you know, and I don't want to just call single families out, but I can say the Golden, the Pierces, the Robinsons, that family, and then Jarvelin, those Pierces, and the Boones and all of them. I see the closeness in the families, and that's a blessing, you all. You need to know that when God gives you a family that you can get together with and you can be close with, that's a blessing. And we don't need to take that for granted, because life is too short, and not everybody has. Not everybody has things that you take for granted. Not everybody has a good relationship with their mother.
or their daughter or their sister. But when you can come together like that and have good times, it is something that I won't say I'm not jealous of, because I don't covet, and that's one of the things that we, in being authentic, we don't need to covet what somebody else had. But you know, I grew up, I'm an only child. My mom's an only child. My son's an only child. And it's just us. And you would think we would be so close. And the truth of the matter is, we haven't always been. But I tried to make sure that me and my son, I mean, you know, I learned from the mistakes that me and my mother made, because I can't put it all on her, because I made some mistakes with it too. So I've learned from those mistakes, and that's what we have to do when life gives us those lemons and when we're giving them back, learn from it. You know, I taste and I see what the bitterness of a broken family can do. So I want to give that lemon back. I don't want a broken family with my son, with my husband, and my relationships with my friends and stuff, you know? So when you tasted that lemon that life has given you and it's bitter, give it back and do something else with it. You know, make amends. If there's anybody in here today, if you're going through some things, if you've got a broken relationship with somebody, fix it. Because life is short, people. You know, he said it as a joke in the movie, but Mr. Brown said people are dying that never died before. I part-time work with a friend who owns a funeral home, and the last three Saturdays that I worked for her, we buried a 19-year-old, a 23-year-old, and a 36-year-old. Two of them were killed in tragic accidents. One of them, the 19-year-old, he was trying to rob someone at an Ace Cash check place in Houston, and somebody else in the store shot him. And the bag that they got out of his hand, and he lost his life behind, all it held was the person's medication.
Lord Jesus.
So this young man lost his life for nothing, and so a mother had to bury her son behind foolishness. But that comes back to us teaching our children, being there for our children, being an example, and giving them. We may not be able to give them everything that they want, but if we give them all that they need, and if we give them this, we give them the word of God. That's the most valuable thing that we can impart into our children's life, into our family's life, into our neighbors, our coworkers. We come across people every day who don't know God. And what are you doing when you come across those people? Are you afraid to talk to them about God because of how you think that they're going to judge you? What kind of life are you living? Some, you know, they say that sometimes we're the only Bible that's right. So we've got to be living a life that when we get up and when we do try to talk, that somebody won't say, well, you can't tell me nothing because I know how you're living. We've got to live a different life. God has called us. He set us apart, and he's equipped us with everything that we need. But we've got to give people the word of God. We've got to get back to the foundation. Because the world is falling apart. It's really sad what's going on in our world, but it's because we have gotten away from the word of God, and we need to go back to that. This last quote says, you did not go through everything you've gone through just to end up in the same place you were when you started. So if you've gone through all your life, and you've been doing the same thing over and over again, how can you expect a different result if you're doing the same thing? Mm-hmm. God has not, the lessons and the things that we've gone through in life, they've been experience that he's given us to build on. Again, I say he's made us the head and not the tail. Yes, so we need to, all that stuff, just pack it under our feet. And you know what happens when you pack stuff under your feet? You keep stepping up a little bit higher, a little bit higher, a little bit higher. So we need to know that when life hands us lemons, we don't have to settle for it. We've got some options. We can give them back. We can make the lemonade. We can do whatever we want to do because we have the power of God beside us. So I ask you as I sit, what are you going to do with your lemons? Amen.